Especially in the week in which the Wardandi people of this area have been grieving along with all other Noongar people at the death of Cassius Turvey. And some of us were able to go and stand with them at the vigil on Wednesday. It's vital that we continue our now practice to acknowledge the Wardandi peoples as the first inhabitants of this place, from time beyond remembering that they call the dream time. We acknowledge that through this land, God nurtured and sustained the first peoples of this country, the Aboriginal and Islander people. We honour them for their custodianship of the land on which we gather today. We acknowledge that the first peoples had already encountered the Creator God before the arrival of the colonizers. The Spirit was already in the land, revealing God to the people through law, custom, and ceremony. We acknowledge that the same love and grace that was finally and fully revealed in Jesus Christ sustained the first peoples and gave them particular insights into God's ways. And so we rejoice in the reconciling purposes of God found in the good news about Jesus Christ. And just to explain, recognize the importance of today as an anniversary, Church Council joined Greg and Andrew in walking in to that song. And I just wanted to also just to sort of recognize that all the other members of Church Council were here and participating in leading the service. Thank you.
And for those of you who haven't recognized the face of my colleague to the left here, this is the Reverend Dr. Andrew Williams, who is the General Secretary of the Synod of Western Australia. This is his first visit to our parish down here since he and his wife, who is also a minister, Reverend Dr. Catalina Tahafo-Williams, who's part of the UCIC ministry in the city, moved from the great metropolis of Darwin to the big metropolis of Perth. So let's welcome Andrew. And Andrew's going to be our guest preacher today, as well as share with me in the celebration of the sacrament. Don't look into the sun, we're told, for the light will hurt our eyes. Don't look at my face, God tells Moses, because you'll be overwhelmed. Today, we choose to look at where God has been, to look at what God has done, and to bow down in worship for the awesome God of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Moses and Zipporah, is present this day in this place. So I invite you to share with me in these responses. So let us praise the Lord. Let us praise the name of the Lord. God has blessed us and brought us to this time. God has blessed us and brought us to this place. God has caused love to dwell in our midst. God has stirred our hearts and made us glad. God has shown us a glimpse of glory in the living Word. God has shown us the way of truth and life. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Give thanks to God. If you're able to stand and sing, I invite you to do so as the band leads us in our next song for this morning, which is Come. Now is the time to worship.
Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time.
and we share together in this prayer of approach. If you have a printed order, the words are in bold. If you're following on the screen, the words, hopefully I've got in the right place, in white. If not, you just read whatever's in white. So we pray. Loving Lord Jesus, we are in your presence and we gather to worship and to praise you. We have come from different places, different families, and different circumstances. However, and wherever we are gathered today, in person or online or on DVD, whether the last week has been good or bad, whether we have known joy or sorrow, let us leave our cares and concerns aside and come united in our faith and hopes for the future. We bring our skills and our talents, which you have given us, and we promise to use them and to reach out in love, showing others what it means to be a child of God. Help us not to just listen to your voice, but to obey. Help us not just to talk, but to be inspired to action, so that all we do is done in your name. Amen. The Vinay and the Benny family are going to come and light the candle for us. They brought their newest member of the congregation to church today, their new little puppy, called Stanley. Yes. And then, do you want to use a firelight? It will match this stuff. Okay.
There was once someone who did such amazing things and said such surprising things that people followed. As they followed, they wondered, who is this? And some people plucked up the courage to ask, who are you? On one of those times, Jesus responded, I am the light of the world. Today we meet in the light and presence of the risen Christ, who is the light of our lives.
Thank you. Make sure you leave Stanley quiet, everyone. Don't sing too loud. And it's lovely for the Benny family to have Doug back home here after having been stuck in Queensland through COVID. So welcome home, Doug. Marg, if you'd like to come up and we'll be ready to, and Glenys, please. So this next part of our liturgy this morning is going to involve just a reminder of us, why we're here. Today, Glenys is going to read to us just a short history of the opening of this building and the steps that and the congregations that it came, and then Marg's going to lead us in a prayer of dedication of ourselves and of next steps of keeping open to God. So join me in these words. Today, on this Sunday, closest to the 20th anniversary of the opening of this building, we have gathered to look back and see the paths taken in the life of this congregation. We look forward seeing Christ ahead of us on our path. We honour those who have gone before us, learning from their successes and failures. We celebrate who we are today and welcome the possibilities and opportunities before us. We have gathered to worship God, the God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Bless us.
Good morning, everyone. This building is Mark III, St. Augustine's Mark III. The architect was Stephen Brett, Phil's brother. The builders were Vincey and Co. The minister at the time was Reverend Ken Williams. And the property committee that did most of the organisation was very small. Ken Tynan, Helen Brett, Gavin Penfold and John Hamblin. Dennis Evans was and Ron Middleton coordinated the fundraising, and Gordon Payne was a treasurer and later Bob. With cement cancer eating away at St. Augustine's Mark II and the box gutters wrecking the ceilings, the congregation agreed it was time to build a new church. To finance the building, nearly half the Mangle Street property needed to be sold. Bequest funds realised. Parish embargoed funds cashed in, a generous fundraising campaign supported, a successful Lotteries Commission grant application granted, and hundreds of hours of volunteer work of church members. The plans for the building incorporated the pipe organ, the bell, and the stained glass window from the first Congregational Church in Prinsep Street, and the internal octagonal sacred space and baptismal dish, three crosses on the external walls, and the hall flooring from the second. The doors on the entrance to here and outside echo the shape of the stained glass window. The foundation stones from the two previous buildings are with the one for this building just outside the front door. The communion table from Prinsep Street is in the foyer, and the deacon's pews are in the Bunbury Museum. The opening service was held on Saturday the 9th of November with liturgical dance and hymns, and the moderator, Reverend Gremmel Sherwood, gave the message. The next day we had worship and an open day with a sausage sizzle and displays. Unfortunately, there was a series of break-ins in the Bunbury area on the Sunday evening, and this included St. Augustine's. We did not have a security system then, and the intruders were very professional. They turned out filing cabinets, pulled cupboards away from walls, removed vents on air conditioning ducts, and emptied the fridge and freezer. All for nothing. This building has been well used by the congregation and the wider community. During the last 20 years, we have installed a security system, repurposed many rooms, refurbished the kitchen, and returned the pipe organ to its original size with the heritage grant. We added a wonderful storeroom, and with changes needed to enable worship during the COVID restrictions, we reorientated the worship space, added our multi-purpose tech desk, and improved the acoustics a bit with curtains. St. Augustine's III is a feel-good space for the congregation and the wider community to worship, to learn, to serve, and enjoy hospitality, just as we are doing today.
Good morning, everyone. Please join me in this litany of thanksgiving. The Lord has blessed us with 20 years of mission and ministry as in this church building. We remember people, and it is good that we remember that God has called us, baptized us, and brought us together as the church of the risen Christ in this place. As a remembering people, we look back at all the saving acts of God, the creation, the flood, the covenant, the exodus, the incarnation, the crucifixion, the resurrection, the church. We are a remembering people, but we're also a people of this day, brought together by God to be a holy fellowship of believers, the body of the risen Christ, sharing, caring, working in the world, and living in the hope of the world to come. Our eyes look back with thanksgiving. Our eyes look forward in hope. Therefore, with thanksgiving for the past and hope for the future, let us dedicate ourselves and our lives to the mission which God gives us as the Church of Jesus Christ in this place. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the work you have done and continue to do in and from this place. We give you thanks for your love and faithfulness. When we call on your name, you make your presence known to us. When we pray, you hear us. When we preach your word and administer your sacraments, you are in our midst. You accept our humble sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving. You listen to our confessions and forgive our sins. And you have sent your Holy Spirit to heal and comfort our hurts, our sorrows, our infirmities, and our losses.
Continue to empower us with your Spirit, O Lord, that we might proclaim your gospel to all people.
We dedicate our lives to your service.
Help us to witness to the good news of Jesus Christ in all that we do and say.
We dedicate our lives to your service.
Show us how we might give care and support to the needy, love and mercy to the broken and excluded.
We dedicate our lives to your service.
Show us new ways of loving one another and those around us.
We dedicate our lives to your service.
Break down those prejudices and barriers which divide us and make us all one in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Renew us by the Spirit given at our baptisms, so that we might be challenged to move beyond our ruts, our apathy, and our anxieties of inadequacy.
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Grant that we may continually grow in the Spirit and in the ministry that you give us as followers of the way of Jesus, so that we may carry out our mission of service and love.
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Continue to comfort, heal, and lift up the broken and afflicted among us. By the promise of your presence, bring us your healing love.
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Bring us at last to the joy of your resurrection life, where with the faithful of this church who have gone before us, and with all your saints, we may evermore praise your name.
Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Blessed Lord, draw our hearts to you, guide our minds, fill our imaginations, control our wills, and make us wholly yours. Use us as you will, to the glory of your holy name and the welfare of your people, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
For more than 50,000 years, God has been in this land. In this building, God has nurtured and fed us for 20 years. Since the dawning of creation, God has been present in word and sacrament. Before the dreaming, God empowered creation with the Holy Spirit. For more than 2,000 years, God has called followers of the way of Jesus to be witnesses in the world. For 2,000 years, the risen Christ has called us to live in loving fellowship with one another. Praise the Lord for 50,000 years. Praise God for 10,000 more. Praise the Lord forevermore. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. If you're able to stand and sing, I invite you to do so as we sing a beautiful hymn by Reverend Carolyn Winfrey Gillette. God, how many are a thousand out of all the grains of sand? It would be remiss of me also not to acknowledge this morning we have several past ministers of the congregation here, Reverend Alan Pedrick, Reverend Gordon Scantlebury, and we also have the minister and colleague who's been working with us for the past 5 years but who next Sunday afternoon will be inducted as the new minister at Willerton Uniting Church, Reverend Mark Bell. Let's please acknowledge those. Very helpful people here. I'd actually closed this twice this morning. Somebody keeps opening it because I was about to do this as part of the liturgy. But anyway. On the mountaintop, after the wind, after the fire, after the silence, you, O God, spoke in the still, small daughter of a voice. Carefully today. fights Red Sea, enemy behind, ocean before, and the parting of the Red Sea through you, O God, brought people to freedom. That's my piano. Let's say together, we are thankful for our baptism. In the garden, just at dawn, with the gardener and tears, you, O God, proved that love was stronger than death. Let us say together, we are not afraid of death. At a table where crumbs even fell. But even the dogs feasted. You, O God, welcome all humankind to one table. We say together, for your unconditional acceptance and welcome, we praise you, O God. In this moment in time, gathered here, each of us waiting for glory revealed by you, O God, we greet each other in peace. Let the peace of the Lord be with you all. In a COVID-safe way, please greet one another with a sign of peace, and Jane and Marg will come to read the scriptures. Today, our readings are from the book of Deuteronomy. Then we're going to sing the psalm. Then we're going to hear from the book of 1 Thessalonians. And then we're hearing from the Gospel of Luke.
The Old Testament reading is from the book of Deuteronomy, and it's the last chapter in the book. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho, and the Lord showed him the whole land. Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, and all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negreb and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, this is the land which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there. Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows where his burial place is to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt, against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land. And for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel.
So let's sing together the psalm. Thank you, musicians.
If you're able to stand and
sing, we invite you to do so.
Our epistle reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 8. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our heart. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed. Nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us.
And the Gospel reading is from Luke chapter 4, beginning at verse 14. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found a place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." He rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of all the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture is being fulfilled in your hearing." May we hear what the Spirit is saying to the church today, for the sake of Christ. Amen.
This is a story I've read before, but I think it's got lots of lessons for us, particularly on a church anniversary Sunday. It's called Bunyip's Don't. Some people have read it and said, old Bunyip is like the church. Young Bunyip lived with old Bunyip in the darkest part of the creek. It was cold and not much fun. "Why can't we live on the sunny side of the creek?" asked young Bunyip.
"Because we're Bunyips, fathead," said Bunyip, "and Bunyips don't."
Young Bunyip sighed. He was very lonely.
"Why don't we make some friends?" he asked.
Old Bunyip laughed. It was like water gurgling down a pipe.
"Bunyips don't."
"Why?"
"Because we're Bunyips, Hammernose, and that's that."
Young Bunyip sat on the sunny side of the creek and listened to the wattle birds.
"What are you doing?" he asked them.
"We're singing," said the wattle birds.
Young Bunyip liked the sound, and when the sun set, he sang too. Old Bunyip surfaced like a snort with a hiss like water boiling over.
"What do you think you're doing?"
"I'm singing," said young Bunyip humbly.
"Well, think again, buckethead," said Bunyip. "Bunyips don't."
"Why?"
"Because they're Bunyips, bark brain."
Young Bunyip was disappointed. But he didn't sing anymore. Instead, he sat on the sunny side of the creek. And he watched the brolgas dancing.
"What are you doing?"
he asked.
"We're dancing," said the brolgas.
Young Bunyip liked their graceful movements. And when the sun set, he tried dancing too. Old Bunyip clambered up from the creek with a gulp like and a suck, like a boot being pulled out of the mud.
"What are you doing?"
"I'm dancing," said young Bunyip.
"Well, don't," snapped old Bunyip.
"Why not?"
"Because Bunyips don't."
"Why?"
"Why? Why?" Old Bunyip rolled his eyes and flung his paws towards the sky. "Because they're Bunyips, tatty ears, and that's why."
and he flopped back into the creek like an old soggy log. "Oh," said young Bunyip, "oh dear, it seemed that Bunyips never had any fun just because they were Bunyips." The next day, young Bunyip sat on the side of the creek and watched some children playing. They laughed and they sang and they ate coloured cake as well. "What are you doing?" young Bunyip asked. The children stared. "We're having a birthday party." "What's that?" "Well," said the children, "it's when you invite your friends and you eat cakes and you sing and dance and have some fun. You can come if you like." Young Bunyip went back to the darkest part of the creek. "Old Bunyip," he called. Old Bunyip heaved from the water like a sloppy pop, with a sloppy pop like a cork coming out of a bottle of wine. "What?" "I suppose," said young Bunyip, "that Bunyips don't have birthday parties."
"You suppose right for once, mud eye," said old Bunyip, "they don't."
And he clambered further up the bank, beginning to wallow away. Where are you going?" cried young Bunyip.
"To find another creek," said old Bunyip, "now that you've finally learned what it is to be a proper Bunyip."
And he crawled out of sight. Young Bunyip went back to the birthday party. The children cut him some cake and they gave him a proper hat. And after that, young Bunyip sang the wattlebird song and he danced the brolga dance. The children taught him some games. It was the best fun Bunyip had ever had. "When's your birthday?" the children asked. "Oh, Bunyips don't have birthdays. Old Bunyip said so." The children laughed. "Everybody has birthdays." Young Bunyip thought for a while. "Then I'll have mine next week." "Where are you going?" the children asked. "To move my house to the sunny side of the creek," said young Bunyip. "Because if old Bunyip was wrong about birthdays, he was probably wrong about the rest too." The end. We're going to jump right over the next slide and we're going to have Andrew bring to us the preaching. You can't see, but if you all look around the back side up there, the offertory, it says I. Over to you. Or you can choose whichever you like, sir. Jared likes you to, you just use whichever.
Don't bring me into this. What would old Bunyip do, there or there?
Probably down amongst the people.
Now I understand why Greg needed to invite me. After doing Bunyip voices like that, he's got no voice left for preaching, I think. It's really good to be with you. And as Greg said, it's my first time to Bunbury. I'm actually a native of South Australia. My South Australian pedigree is impeccable. But we've moved all around the shop and we were sort of heading home. We'd been on another overseas jaunt in Geneva and came back to Darwin. I thought we were happily settled there. And then we finish up in Perth, where we've never lived before. It's very exciting. So here we are. The 20th anniversary of this building. Who was here for the opening? Let's just check. Okay, quite a few of you. Yes, very good. And who's the oldest person here? Come on now. It's not meant to be a rude question.
Audrey, we think.
Audrey, we think. Okay. We're not going to ask you, Audrey, but we're just going to believe that that's right. And I guess if you've been around, very old, is that? Is that signalling very old? Okay. I guess if you've been around, you've seen some changes over the years, in the last 20 years or longer. Things change, things are different, churches change, neighbourhoods change, even whole societies change. We know that we change as we get older. I remember the days when it seemed like Christmas or a birthday would never get here. And now I think, is it here again already? You too? Well, lots of things change with age. Not long ago, my brother sent me a DVD that someone had downloaded from an old, Super 8 film or something. And it's of me and some mates when we rode our bikes from Adelaide to Canberra for the National Christian Youth Convention in about 1977. So I'm about 18, I think, in that video, DVD, and lots of things were different. One thing you noticed straight away is you didn't have to wear helmets, and so we're zipping up and down the road like young people about to go on this great adventure. Things change. I went for a ride on my bike yesterday. It didn't feel quite the same as the zippy young man in that DVD that I saw. I got an email from a friend not long ago, one of those, ones that gets bounced around. We probably all get them from our friends, the funny ones and those sort of things. And it was telling me some of the things that I needed to notice. And it was entitled, "You're Not a Kid Anymore When." And it goes, "You're not a kid anymore when your back goes out more than you do." "You stop trying to hold your stomach in, no matter who walks into the room. Your arms are almost too short to read the newspaper. You sing along with the shopping centre music. You're proud of your lawnmower." Oh, that's a good one. "People call at 9 p.m. and ask, 'Did I wake you?'" Well, you get the picture. Another friend who retired recently said, "I took ginkgo tablets." Is it ginkgo or jinko? I don't know. Ginkgo. I've seen them in the shop. "I took ginkgo capsules for a time last year after my 50th birthday." Ginkgo is meant to be one of those things that helps retard memory loss as you get older. But he said, "I stopped taking them when I realised I'd forgotten to take them for a week." Okay, you got the idea. The psalm this morning, Psalm 90, is one of my favourites. And psalms should always be sung, so well done. We sang the psalm, I'm very happy about that. But you won't have picked up some of the nuances in it from that beautiful and familiar version of Psalm 90. We often hear this psalm at funerals, Psalm 90. I love the opening line in the Good News Bible translation, which says, "O Lord, you have always been our home." In the New Revised Standard, it's, "O Lord, you have always been our dwelling place." Choose which one you like. But remember some of the phrasing in this psalm. "All generations, everlasting to everlasting, 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it's past, or like a watch in the night." There's the reminder of how transitory is the nature of human life. Humanity is like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and withers. Our days pass away. Our years come to an end like a sigh. Then perhaps the most famous words, which you might have learned or remembered from the King James Version, in which many of us probably were nurtured, "The days of our years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labour and sorrow, for it's soon cut off and we fly away." So if you're over the 80 years and 10, you're doing okay. I think we might have something about that later, but anyway. Well, what are we going to say about this psalm? Is it a bit too depressing? Perhaps, but not necessarily. Psalm 90 really should be the old age pensioner's theme song. This is a hymn for grown-ups. Yes, it takes seriously the passing of the years, as any mature person does. It takes seriously the fleeting nature of human life, and the older we get, the more likely we are to read the obituaries every day and wonder how it is that people always die in alphabetical order. We may not get to add more years to our life, but surely we can add more life to our years. If we go about the process with some wisdom. The psalmist's prayer is, so teach us to count our days that we may gain a wise heart. Wisdom, Lord, give us wisdom so that we can make the most of these fleeting years. Age, it appears, shouldn't be a hindrance to anything. So 20 years, just out of adolescence. Not too much to worry about. However, I know that this is not the first church on this site, and we'll get to that in a minute. So whether we turn to the gospel reading, Jesus in Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and on the Sabbath, he goes to the synagogue. So usually when we're having a church anniversary, and particularly here today, we're thinking about our church community, past and present, but we also think about the building, and quite specifically our place of worship. We give thanks for those who planned it, who built it, who've cared for it. And so I was trying to make notes as fast as I could as people were telling that story. So the opening was on the 9th of November, I remember someone saying. And because it was an Aussie church opening, there was a sausage sizzle. I love it. And then there was the break-in from day one. There's much to reflect on here. I like too that, am I right in thinking that Ken Williams was the minister 20 years ago? So obviously you need a Williams person to come and preach today. I get the you know, symbolism of that. And that Gemmell Sherwood was the moderator who did the opening ceremony. So I interesting. In our gospel reading today, we heard about Jesus going to his local place, his family place of worship, the synagogue of Nazareth. What do we know about the building where Jesus first worshipped? Well, the simple answer is not a lot. Nazareth was a tiny agricultural village off the main trade routes, and it's never mentioned in the Old Testament. A hilltop site has been suggested for the synagogue, but that's not certain either. And as to who built it, no one kept any records. We don't know. Nazareth, however, we do know, supported the rebellion against Rome in AD 70. And it's highly likely that the synagogue Jesus knew would have been destroyed and rebuilt sometime later. The only thing we know for sure about the synagogue in Nazareth is that Jesus of Nazareth stood there and read from the scriptures. And he proclaimed the gospel. Good news to the poor, freedom to the captives, sight to the blind, release for the oppressed. And that, of course, is the key issue for every church and every chapel, wherever and whenever they are built. Is it a place like the Nazareth synagogue on that day of old? Is it a place where the scriptures are read and in their reading the voice of Jesus is heard? Is it a place where we are confronted by the challenge and promise of the gospel? Now, I've been to Nazareth. Anybody else been to Nazareth? A few of us. And one of the sites in Nazareth is this church called the Church of Jesus the Adolescent. Did you go into it? No, don't remember it? It's a big and impressive kind of a church. The Church of Jesus the Adolescent. And so, because I've got a particular kind of mind, I'm looking in the pews, you know, wooden pews. I'm expecting to see JC carved into there or some chewing gum under the pew there where Jesus the Adolescent has been seated. Of course, there was none of that. It's actually a really beautiful church, sort of a cathedral, very, very nice. Jesus the Adolescent lived in Nazareth and he grew up there and he must have known that place well. So on our anniversary day, we come, we give thanks for those who first built a place of worship here in this place. We give thanks how from generation to generation the scriptures have indeed been read and the gospel proclaimed. We give thanks for this place where the risen Christ has indeed stood among us and spoken to his people and proclaimed again the dream of God's coming kingdom. Now, what I also heard is that this is not the first church. And I took by that that it's not the first church on this site. Is that right? Okay. So this is church number 3 on this site.
Number 2
was in town. The first one was in town. That's what I'm saying, good. Thank you for correcting me. This is church number 2 on this site, and the other one, 1875, I think I saw on the foundation stone, was somewhere else. Okay. Well, the next point I want to make is, well, buildings come and buildings go. What changes have you seen here, even in this place? And you began to list them when we heard about it. There's a new security system for some reason after the opening day. The kitchen's been refurbed, I heard. The organ got a new lease of life, yes? Yes. And you added a storeroom. Yes. You improved the sound system. Yes. But there was also the mention of the things that have been incorporated into this site. And I noticed the stained glass windows and some of the other things. The foundation stones from the previous building. The flooring from building number 2. I was listening. The bell. All these things got included. Well, what can we say? For 20 years? For 100 years? For however long we've been the church community here in Bunbury, this, or the place in town, Gordon, thank you, or the place in town, has been holy ground. And we give thanks today for the generations who've worshipped here, who have met with Christ here, and heard the gospel proclaimed, and dreamed their dreams of the kingdom here. The gospel which has been proclaimed not only in word, but also in deed. The good news of the poor has been lived as well as spoken. Times change. But in the best of times, and perhaps especially in the worst of times, people live out the dreams of the gospel in this place. Greg was saying that there used to be some situation where you'd come in and check how deep was the puddle of water that you were stepping into. Is that in the old building? Some things have changed and improved. But here's the message for you who are feeling great about getting this far. It's no good having a building unless Christ is found there proclaiming the gospel. It's no good hearing the word of the gospel unless we respond and live it out in the city where God has placed us. Of course, we all know what happened to Jesus when he brought the gospel to the synagogue in Nazareth. People listened and then turned away. This was just Joseph's son, a prophet without honour in his own country. I pray that that will not be the case here. We gather in this sacred place, hallowed by generations, to hear Jesus speak to us fresh words each week. His words challenge us with dreams and hopes of a new world. Unlike the people of Nazareth of old, I pray that we may hear the words, catch the vision, and live the dream. I want to also suggest, from what I've heard this morning, that this place has been a building site on and off for at least the past 20 years, and if you had to knock down a church to do this one, what was the date of the church number two? 1970. So we could go back to 1970 and say, at the very least, this has been a building site since 1970 here. Now, perhaps it didn't take as long as a European cathedral to complete this building, but we've added to it as we've gone along. The process was not static then, and it's not finished yet. And I know that from what you've told me you've already done in the last 20 years. So here's my next question. How are you preparing to build again? Will there be church number three on this site? If history teaches us anything, it's that over the years we need to refurbish and redevelop to cope with the crises of the past and to cope with the challenges of the future. But as in every generation, I pray that we will build well and worthily of those who've gone before us. I like to think that as we pray about our work here, there are early pioneers of this place who are looking down on us, who remember this place. And I wonder if we will please them. Only, I suspect, if our church is more than bricks and mortar. Only if it opens its doors to the needs of the world. Only if it hears and lives the dreams of peace and justice, which are the gospel. We don't know what the future holds. We don't know what the future holds for this church, for Australia, for the world. As we read our papers and hear the news and think of the future, we sometimes may wonder whether some of the things that the people of this church over that vast span, some of the things that they lived through, depression, world wars, winning and losing the ashes so many times, a change perhaps in the ethnic makeup of the area, are but the beginnings of the sufferings we must one day bear in this place. I don't know. We may not be saved from all trouble here, but really, that's not what matters. What matters is that as God's people, we still love and dance and eat birthday cake and dream. There may be trouble ahead, but as long as we build with the Lord, as long as we listen to the man of Nazareth speaking to us, as long as we open the doors of our church and our lives to the needs of the poor and marginalized and lost, as long as our young see visions and our old dream dreams of a better world, as long as we are filled with the Spirit, as long as we dance the resurrection story, as long as there are songs of love and dreams of peace in this place, then whatever the world may throw at us, this place will continue to be a beacon of hope in a dark world. In the liturgy earlier, in the Litany of Thanksgiving, we talked about our eyes look back with thanksgiving and our eyes look forward in hope. Someone once said, hope is stronger than memory. So today we do a lot of remembering of all those good things, but I want to believe that the hope of what is yet to come for this community and this place is what drives us forward, not the memory of any glory days that were behind us. Then we can build. We can build with the Lord. And as the psalmist said of old, those who build with the Lord shall not build in vain. Psalm 90 says, Lord, you have always been our home. Amen.
Thank you, Andrew. Our stewards, many of you just place your offering each week into the bank account. We thank you so much for that. Our stewards will bring the offering bowl around for those who like to bring theirs to the building. There will be a video song played during this, and then we'll share the offertory prayer. Treasure that is shared from this place and from our lives. Amen. Reese and Michelle. So folks, this morning Andrew and I are going to share in the celebration of the sacrament. Reese and Michelle are going to assist us. We will be serving from here. And those of you, if you cannot get up and come, there's no compulsion to do that. Once people have come to receive the bread and the wine, we're happy to come to those of you who find it difficult to walk. You just need to wave or have your accompanier to say, the bread is all gluten-free. The grape juice is grape juice. And we'll have you come up the middle aisle to where we will offer you the bread and wine and then go around the outside so that we get that one, hopefully, to communion, to conga lines is probably not the word, but when we were talking about dancing the new life, I was thinking, oh, we could sing the conga line. Let's share in this invitation. Here is the company of heaven, seen and unseen. Here is the bread to be broken and wine to be spilled. Would you like to take the covers off, please? Here is Jesus the Christ, holy rebel and sacred friend. This is the belonging place. Here are the people of God, saints and sinners. Here is the congregation, not just of here, but of heaven. Those ready and those not ready to receive. Here is the story of God, crucified and risen. This is the belonging place. Here is the table of life, open and free. Here is the grace of God, unconditional and without end. Here is the love of Jesus, given and given again. This is the belonging place. Whoever we are and aren't, whatever we believe and don't, we belong here at this table.
Lord Jesus Christ, you have invited us to come to this table. We have come from many places and experiences. We have come with all our differences. We have come to the place where journeys meet. You have called us into the heart of God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he told his friends to prepare a place for him. And then he offered us a sign of how he would give himself to us to give us new life. He had always loved us, and now he showed us how perfect his love was. While his disciples were eating, Jesus took a piece of bread in his hands like this, and he blessed it. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. And then he said to them, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then Jesus took a cup of wine like this and gave thanks. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. And then he said to them, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." His disciples did not understand these words. How could they understand? But later they would see Jesus' body broken, his very life poured out, so that we might share his risen life. The life he gave then, he shares with us now. Lord Jesus Christ, as we do in this place what you did once with your friends, we ask that you might once again breathe your Holy Spirit upon us and on this bread and wine. May they become for us heaven's food, renewing, transforming, sustaining, and making us whole, so that we may be your body on earth, loving and caring for your creation, where all are welcome and the poorest are fed. Bless the earth, heal the sick, let the oppressed go free, and fill each one of us with your love from on high. Gather all people from the ends of the earth to feast at your table with all your saints. Let us pray together in this version of the Lord's Prayer. Eternal Spirit, earth maker, pain bearer, life giver, source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe, the way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world, your heavenly will be done by all created beings, your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil,
free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Look, Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven, is broken for the life of the world. See, the loving grace of God poured out without restriction, the gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus, bread of life, bread on the edge, bread for the world. So, folks, if you'll come with your hands out so that we can drop the bread into your hands and then take the cup and be on your way. Thank you.
Let us pray with thanksgiving. God of hope, in bread and wine you have restored us to relationship with you. Show us how to be a people that live your reconciling love in the world, so that we may recognize your presence in those we meet, and our hearts, like those first disciples, may burn within us upon the road.
Lord Jesus Christ, you are the word for us to speak. You are the truth for us to tell. You are the light for us to light in the darkness. You are the bread of life for us to share.
Now all of us must go into the world and live God's love there. Look for Jesus in the oppressed and burdened. Look for Jesus in those who have lost hope. Look for him among the poor in heart, among the merciful, among the peacemakers, among the persecuted for the sake of right. Look for Jesus on the edge. We're going to sing together this final hymn. Oh, it's one that I wrote. But it sort of fits well with our theme for today. In a church that's moving forward, not a church that's always looking back, may it be the church where you, like me, long to be.
So, go simply, lightly, gently. Go with obedience. Go with love. And the blessing of God, creating Father and Mother, life-giving Son and empowering Spirit, is with you now and forever. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Please have a seat just for a second. In a moment, a whole lot of you have bought food for munch, which is morning tea and lunch together. There are also several of you who have had more birthdays than this building. Is that some of you? Okay. And so we're hoping that all of you who are staying, because there are a bunch of us who've had more than 20 birthdays. Actually, they've had more than four lots of 20, but anyway, who have contributed to a booklet, which we're going to launch over morning tea. And then we've got a certificate for those people who've contributed to the booklet to give with a printed copy of the booklet. That will be in a frame. And then we hope, and please, because we're God's people and we're forgiving, if you happen to be a person who has reached more than 80 and we have missed you, forgive us and we will print you a certificate. But we think we've got all those people who are over blooming 80. We think we've got a certificate for all of you signed by Professor Richard Hugman, who's the chair of our congregation, and by Reverend Dr. Andrew Williams, who's the secretary of the synod. So we hope that all of you are going to stay for that. This is not going to be a long, drawn-out affair, but it's a time for us to be together, to celebrate the past, and as Andrew said, to look to the future with hope. And one of the things that we've asked each of those who've contributed to the OBE booklet is, what is the gift of faith that you want to hand on to the next generation? What is the gift of faith? So, are you ready to dance out to morning tea? Okay, because I think they're going to play One More Step Along the Road I Go. Okay, let's dance out.